Amen. Amen. I feel very privileged to be speaking in this church today. And that's pretty mean to do to somebody just before you speak. I'm privileged to be here because of who you are, how you have risen to more than any city, any community should ever have to rise to. I'm privileged to be here as in some way an ambassador of Jesus Christ, who's just the best that I have to offer. I won't cry the whole time, I promise. You know, the Apostle Paul today was writing from such a deep place in his heart, and he said, the Holy Spirit groans for us, bends in and in our pain, and groans for God's people who are suffering, groans for God's people who are sad, groans for God's people who are carrying heavy burdens. We are not invisible to God. And together, we can carry one another's pain as well. And you know where we carry it? To the best place I know of, right to the lap of Jesus Christ. Yes, to the heart of Jesus Christ. Because we have a Savior at the center of our faith who understands suffering. In the story of Jesus of Nazareth's life here on earth, he understood suffering. And not only at the end, of course, the great story in Christianity is the story of sadness to hope from Good Friday to Easter, right? That is the great spiritual archetype that you and I are to always draw strength from in a whosoever gospel, as the community of John said, right? Which is where our hope comes in MCC, right? The whosoever gospel. Because that one word in Greek, I thank God for that one word in Greek, amen? I thank God for that one word. Because that one word gave voice to my experience and to many other people's experience of God's love never left. Church may have left. Friends may have left. But God's love never left. And that is the promise in Jesus the Christ. He said, the first shall be last and the last shall be first. And you know what one of his first sermons is? His big sermon, his Joel Osteen sermon. I don't boo me on that, okay? In his time, the Sermon on the Mount in one gospel, the Sermon on the Plains in the other, wherever it happened, people remembered it. You know, whatever the geography was. He said, blessed are you who mourn. For one day, you will laugh. You will have hope. A couple of weeks ago, on a beautiful Saturday, my partner and I just moved to Clearwater, Florida, and from Dunedin, Florida, and that was 5 miles, so a big move. We moved there, and we are kind of setting up house for the first time together, and so it's been a journey. It's been exciting. You know, it's the whole suburban life, which I kind of have to get my mind around. I've lived a lot of my life in cities and small towns. But it's fun. It's, you know, nice to have grass to mow and things like that. I know you're praying for me right now, aren't you, that I would call that fun. But it's fun for us, and we're setting up life in a new way. And for me, this represents a new beginning after a lot of endings in my life from a very long relationship and in the past. And so this is great. And last Saturday, I was going to kick off and go back to the gym. You know, it's another fresh start, you know. Been there, done that, right? Amen. And so I came out the door and I looked, and on my soul, which is my car, there were things drawn all over it. And they were male parts drawn all over it. And on the back was a message I'm not going to repeat here. And I just was stunned for a moment. And I went back inside and told my partner to come out, and he looked at it, and we just were quiet for a moment. And he went back inside. He's a Missouri goat farmer, so, you know, they're kind of quiet. I don't know if any of you are Missouri goat farmers here, but what would the odds be, right? So, you know, because this isn't the first time, you know, you can't live to be a 52-year-old gay man and it be the first time you've experienced something like that, or anybody, LGBTQIA. You know, so it wasn't that this was the worst thing that's ever happened in life, but it was a bad thing that happened. And it does have an impact on you in a neighborhood you hoped would be safe, right? That now you have been identified, and all day long your neighbors have been walking by that car. The neighborhood children have been walking by that car. So I did what everybody does now. I did a video for Facebook. And I normally don't do this. I'm very quiet about these kinds of things. But I wanted in the moment to see, can I share what it really feels like when something like this happens to you? And I tried to capture that. And I also tried to say, and this is what you do. Don't ignore it if it does happen. Acknowledge that it has happened. And we're going to continue to love our neighborhood. And we're going to continue to make our home in this place. And we're going to continue to be great neighbors and love our neighbors and all that stuff that you do in the moment. And a few hours later, I noticed that someone had shared my video. And it was a young man that I hadn't really heard of since I was on staff in MCC New York. And this was back in the 90s. And this person, well, he was younger then, and maybe he's not so young now. I still think of us as young men, but we're not really, are we? You can tell me the truth. We're in church. And on there, he had shared it, you know, because he was kind of angry that it happened and everything, and said, I want to tell you about this person because they saved my life. And he had remembered that he had come to my office when I was on staff, and I remembered him very clearly, of course, after this, but and he had been addicted to heroin, really, really addicted to heroin. And at this point, it was sort of chemicals. You know, when you were talking with him, you were really talking to chemicals. And he had a little grandmother, and we arranged that his grandmother could send him money through me at the church because all of the rest of the family had cut him off. You know, as sometimes you need to do in the kind of tough love. I think there had been many second, third, fourth, 12th, 20th chances. But grandmother never did, and grandma kept sending things. And we would talk and stuff, and somewhere in that he remembered through the haze of it all that God had given me the words to share with him, which is, you are worth being loved, even when you're using. You are worth God's love when you're using. And something about that worked in him and on him, and he credits that with saving his life and turning him around, and he has. He now leads human rights organizations and is doing amazing work out there. But in these stories, I want to just remind you and remind all of us that we can carry one another's pain. We can carry it as the body of Christ together. And we know where to take it, though. Do you know what I mean? We don't just leave it. We know where to take it. We can take it together in prayer. We can take it together in community. We can take it together in action. And begin to transform this world into the kingdom of Christ. That he said, I need you in order to do this. each and every one of you in order to do this. And the Apostle Paul tells us today, this is your birthright. God knew who you were. The psalmist said God knit you together in your mother's womb. Knew exactly who you were and knew that there was a holy purpose for your life. Just as you are, exactly as you are, all that you are in the sadness and in the hope. Do not let your sadness make you think you are unworthy. Do not let the sadness the world hands us define us. Do not let sadness become our only story. As you were talking about pride today, I was thinking of my friend Roland Jide McCauley. Reverend Jide McCauley is Nigeria's Troy Perry, one of the first people to really lead people into a new day, and has taken a lot of the brunt of that, being the leader of that as well. And Jide was recently in Uganda, where they had one of their most public pride events ever. And just as they were feeling confident, the police raided it. And they arrested people, and they released some people's names to family and in public and other people. And he described it that they had to sit on the floor with their hands above their head while they could hear them roughing up other people there. And he was talking about how he mosquitoes came into his bedroom. He's back in London now, and something about them triggered nightmares from that. But he said what I've heard him say many times, which is, I will not let sadness and fear define me. I will take it to Jesus Christ, who will transform it for the good. And he reaffirmed once again what I've heard him say many times. He said, I am still a diva. And what he means by that is divinely inspired, victoriously anointed. Amen? Amen. I am divinely inspired, victoriously anointed. You want to say that with me, divas?
Yeah.
I am divinely inspired, victoriously anointed. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. And he was right back out there. In spite of the sadness, in spite of the fear, the sadness that he has carried for many, many years, for many, many people, carries it to the heart of Christ. My friends, I'd like to ask you, perhaps even charge you this morning, to not see Pride Orlando as a regular pride this year. This city needs people who are willing to carry one another's pain this year, who are willing to carry it with hope, who are willing to get on your big old conspicuous fabulous float and sing the gospel message across this city. Amen?
Amen.
To get out there and walk with that float if you can walk. Show up. I am God's child and I am walking, which means you are God's child and could be walking as well. Sadness will not define us. We are a part of a new revelation of God. We are a part of the revelation that God's love is more inclusive than the church has ever taught it before in the church's history. Do you understand what we carry in our bodies, in our lives, and in our faith? That is you. That is not Reverend Terry only. That is not your staff only. It is you. You are an ambassador of Christ. And you've got your own sadnesses, amen?
Amen?
And you can take it to Jesus Christ to transform that sadness. That is my good news for you today. And when it is transformed, say, Holy God, use me. Some way. Let me love the world in my own unique way. The only way you know I can. And you know what? God will. Because Paul says at the end of his life, after all of the trials and the tribulations, after all the friends who have been oppressed, who have been killed and martyred. He says, I still believe that nothing, no one, no angels, no governments, no churches, right? No bullies. Nothing, not even my own heart. Do you know he says that God is even wiser than our own heart when it condemns us because of internalized stuff, right? Nothing can keep us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ. My friends, I stand on that message today. If you have not gotten it, may you be blessed. May you hear it. May you open up. May you say, God, help me understand this. I need to understand it further. Heal my sadness, that I might be hopeful once again. And it will be so in the name of Jesus Christ. Let this people proclaim good news by saying amen this morning.
Amen. Amen.